and you expect that, okay, you find a sheet that has been prepared by maybe BFID or CBN that tells you that tax is going to be 30%. Nah. I remember sometimes you have to go on Google speech. Like, go and research the speech from their DGs and co. So maybe the guy is just talking, I'm like, yeah, in the next 10 years, we are looking at normalizing taxes at between 30 to 40%. I'm telling you, that's where you're going to get the information from, in a speech. So you can't be thinking that all the time your research was coming in the form of a table. Inflation, 88%, 99%, 2005. It doesn't come like that most of the time. Okay? So, but you still have to research, right? Because you have to quote your source. So in this one, I think I was able to get these figures from these three guys. Now, it's not a boss that you have three case scenarios. This is a three case scenario model. We have the base case, which is normal case. Then you have the best case, which is what you hope would happen. Then you have the worst case scenario as well, which is like, oh my God, I'm not getting on. All right. So there are some models you find. They have like five different scenarios. There are some models that have like six, seven, eight. There are no rules to number of scenarios you can create in the model. As long as you are willing to put in the work, all right? Maybe you are there's this girl in your firm. She's like the best analyst, and you're trying to prove to everybody that you're better than her, and you're a maker, right? So what you do is what? You go and do, maybe the girl did three cases, you're just going to do 10 cases. So that the whole firm will be like, oh my God, this is the new standard. They send to the CEO, the CEO will send a mail to the whole team, to the whole firm. Now, Emeka is the standard for financial modeling. Alright, so when it's promotion time, they'll remember. So there are no hard and fast rules about number of scenarios. Maybe your boss, because the truth is, if you are coming to me with more than three scenarios, I will not look at it. So I'll be like, oh, but you just do three. I'm fine. So your boss could say that you should do three, but if they say do six or whatever, you have to do it. So this is a 3K scenario and whatever. Then there's another scenario for currency, right? Because this business is exposed to two currencies, basically, Naira and dollars. So I had to do a scenario for both Naira and dollar as well. So you can toggle, let me see, if I change this now, for example, this is toggle. If I change to best case, can I see numbers flip? Can I see that numbers flip? Did you get notice? Let me change to worst case now. You know that numbers flip, buddy? Then when you change maybe to dollars, okay, you will not notice dollars here. Let me see income statement or something. Yeah, income statement. So dollars now. Let me change that to Naira. Can you see? Then back dollars. Best case dollars. Best case Naira. Yeah, so those are two types of scenarios that was taken care of in this model. Secondly is, I've mentioned your inputs. Inflation was the first thing. Then we now turn inflation to a factor. You know, inflation comes in percentages. 10%, 5%, whatever percent is a rate. Inflation is a rate, right? So I have to change it to a factor. The reason why we have to change it to a factor, what is the factor? What is the difference between a factor and a rate? Who knows? Math students. Are there any mathematics students here? Engineering? You did engineering before. No? So what is the difference factor and rate? No difference, actually. It's just an expression. So if you want to express 10%, 10% is a rate. It's a rate. You can say that inflation is going to be rate of 10%. You want to express this as a factor. What are you going to express that? No. 10% of what? What is 10%? 10% is 0.1. 0.1, right? So I'm correct. 1.1. All right. So you're saying that if I so let's do this simple mathematics. Let's pick a very very easy number, 100. Emeka is going his girlfriends. Emeka has 100 girlfriends. guys, concentrate. Emeka has 100 girlfriends, but Emeka has been growing his girlfriend at the rate of 10%. So, annually. So, next year, how many girlfriends does Emeka have? Eh? 110. Am I right? So, Emeka has 110 girlfriends now in 2019. Do you get? If you de facto, Emeka has 100 girlfriends. But Emeka has been increasing his girlfriends year on year by a factor of 1.10. How many girlfriends will Emeka have next year? Huh? So do you know the difference between factor and rate? What's the difference? It's just a decimal, expression of percentages, more or less. Does that make sense? So you can see here that inflation is supposed to be 8.5, it's like 9%, and by the time you get it, it's 1.09. Can you see here? Then it's 8.05, which is like 8%, 1.08, and so on and so forth. Can you see? Can you see that? So that's inflation factor. So the reason why it was converted to a factor is because we're going to be multiplying, we're going to be doing a lot of multiplication in the model going down forward, all right? So instead of having to deal with rates, which are very hard to deal with in Excel, because now we remember that it's in percent. Do you get? And sometimes percentages have a way of affecting, because say for example, 10%. What's 10%? So if I want to say Emeka's girlfriend, see the mathematics here. For you, so you can see why we use factor. Emeka has 100 girlfriends. And he has been growing his girlfriends at rate of 10%. So Emeka's girlfriends by, when he gets his number of girlfriends by the end of 2019, what do you first do? You say 100 times 10%, right? What is that? Equals 10. We now say what? 100 plus 10 equals. So you have to do this in two steps. Does that make sense? You have to do the work in two steps. So imagine if you have to do it in model. So you have to stage step one and stage step two. Does that make sense, guys? Does that make sense? Like, you have to do this in Excel. It means that you have to first do this. Then you now have to do this again. Which are two stages. But if you use, if you express as factor, you just what? 1.10 times 100. It gives you 110. So it's, instead of doing it on two stages, you just do it on one stage. Does that make sense? So that's why it's expressed as a factor instead of as a rate. Does that make sense? Question.
So can growing number by percentage, what does that do to number times the ratio of 1 to 10?
Yeah, you can do that too. You can do that too, but the expression of it in Excel, because you have to stage, like I said, if that changes, you can't be add coding it. You have to stage, right? I spoke about staging earlier. So you can't be upcoding. So if you want to do that, you can do that. It's fine. You can do that. That's rate of increase. Formula for rate of increase. And some people call it compounding. Because, right? Uh-huh. So or you can call it discounting. You are reducing. Uh-huh. So, yeah, you can do that. But you have to stage it. But it's easier when you just make it a factor and you just multiply that factor directly. So does that make sense? So it's just ease. If you think that you want to be a nerd, well, it's not a bad thing to be a nerd. But if you think that it's easier for you, yeah, we all saw you. Everybody, the Okwa saw you. So now, if you think it's easier for you to, I mean, express as a rate, I mean, go ahead, knock yourself out, right? Does that make sense? Now, then we have a function we call, or let me say, factor. We call it cumulative inflation factor. Now, the reason for that cumulative inflation factor is when we get terminal value calculation. All these things might sound very abstract to you now. Don't worry. When you are trying to work it out, it's very easy. So when you're trying to work out, what do you call it? Terminal value. You know, I said terminal value is into perpetuity, right? So how do you tell inflation rate in 10 years time? Inflation rate 10 years time into perpetuity. How can you tell that? Because you think that inflation rate in 10 years time is a cumulative of inflation rates from the past. Does that make sense? So you have to now, do you guys know what cumulative means? I mean, you all use cumulative CGPAs, right? So you know that, you know, precept of the next is based on the before, right? So that's exactly what this is. So I think this is multiplied across. Yeah, everything is multiplied across. Let me see. Yeah, it's multiplied across. Product. Because product all the way. So this figure, 1.92, is a combination of all the figures preceding it. So this is the true performance. So if you are thinking of performance of the economy, this 1.92 is a more significant, expression of inflation in 2020 than 1.09. Does that make sense, guys? Does that make sense? Is it making sense? If it's not making sense, please ask your questions. You want to ask a question? All right. So that's why, yeah. No, it doesn't. Japan has been expressing negative inflation for years. In fact, they are struggling to keep inflation, to make inflation go back up. They are in, I mean, their economy has perpetually been what you call deflationary mode. So it's not a must. And when you are in a recession, inflation goes down too. So inflation is not particularly a bad thing. Do you get? But it can be bad if it's not checked. What is it from? Okay, 1.08, that's the flat factor. Okay, so are you an economist? No. What are economists in the house? Guys, so when you guys make assumptions, I mean, you were taught modeling, right? And there's a part of modeling where they taught you assumptions. So how do you make assumptions? Based on past trends. Yes. And that method of making assumptions. From nowhere. But that's not really promoted in science, because arbitrary assumptions nobody does it. It's almost a taboo. The only reason why you arbitrarily pick a figure is that, okay, you've tried all your best to get a trend analysis and you can't get it. And that is almost not possible in this modern age. So assumptions are not things that you can just randomly pick out of thin air. You get? So even though there's a possibility that, you know, inflation might decrease, because for example, in Nigeria, right now, as I'm speaking to you, since second quarter of last year, inflation has been decreasing. Inflation was about 17% or so, and now it's about 12.1%. You said? 11. Oh my God. I'm so sorry. I won't do that again. I'm so sorry. 11.61%. So that's supposed to show that inflation has been decreasing in Nigeria, as a matter of fact. You get? But can you make that assumption 20 years ago? No. Because this scenario, as I told you, this is the second time in the history of Nigeria that inflation will be decreasing. Second time ever. Nigeria is how old? Over 50 years. And this is the second time in the history of the country that inflation will be decreasing. The first time happened after Obasanjo became, president. Second time he's becoming president. That's when we went from double digits to one digit in a very long time. Passenger ended his presidency at 9%-ish, thereabouts. And between that time and Jonathan's time, it became 7-point-something. Then Babubu came. Then he took it back to 17. Right? Then Babubu is bringing it back down now. We're going to get there. All right? Support him. I don't know what you're supporting for. I didn't say something. I just said supporting. Right. So basically, there's a scenario where that can happen. All right. But you can't just arbitrarily pick those scenarios. Except there's a trend that justifies that. Does that make sense? Besides, you can, like I said, this model is largely reliant not on even primary research, but on secondary research. You know the difference between primary and secondary research? Exactly. So and that's why we are quoting the source. Because these guys, they're actually well-established, you know, research firms. I'm sure you guys have heard about Trading Economics before, have you? Do you guys know Index Mungo? Index Mundi, rather. Index Mundi is also a very popular research firm. You guys know about, of course, CIA Fact File, EU Fact File. You know CIA has a Fact File that's open to the public. Just Google CIA Fact File. You can't Google Nigeria, you see the number of police you have, number of soldiers you have, number of children, number of women. They have it. They keep a Fact File of the country that even your own country does not keep. Yeah. So CIA Fact File is a very good place to find stuff. EU, European Union, they keep the Fact File as well. Of course, IMF, World Bank, they all keep research Fact File. And it's open to the public. And you go on their website and check it out. CBN as well is a very good source. Of course, the CBN, what's their job? Then Nigerian Bureau of Statistics, NBS. And then you have a lot of other research work. Maybe you download a research from one professor from Unilag or something. You must have done some work that you can reference and all of that. But most of the time, if you are working with clients, you most likely want to quote, you know, well-established statistical organizations. Now, here's the trick. Most likely, they will give you their statistics for free. So when you go to Index Mundi, for example, most of the statistics you will see are not recent. So you think that they are not good. No, they are actually really good. But they will not open because they cost them money. So they sell that research. They actually sell those research. So when you work for a firm, your firm most likely has subscriptions with many of these research firms, right? So you have access to that. That's different between you that you're working in, that you're doing your own business, and someone that's working maybe in a place like Goodman. Because someone like Goodman, we have subscriptions with Foreign Economics and all those things. And those ones are like very huge on research. That's all they do. That's their content. So they're giving you every month. In fact, there are some research firms that they update your Fact File every day with scenario analysis. If you do Foreign Economics, it's a UK-based, very large Excel sheet, and they'll be sending you updates every day. And I'm not joking. That's their job. That's what they do. They'll be sending you updates every day, like something has changed. And they give you minimum 10 different scenarios. 10. They'll tell you that inflation in Nigeria. They give you 10 different quotes of inflation in Nigeria. That this person said. So they are not a research firm, they are a research aggregator firm. So they aggregate research across the world. So, I mean, I used to have a subscription with them. It's amazing. So that's where you find things like this. So you have to quote your source, because when you are speaking to the client and you go like, yeah, we believe that inflation in 2020 will be 9.03%. And the guy goes like, why do you believe that? And I'm like, well, I mean, Trading Economics, which is a popular name. Bloomberg is also a popular name. I mean, those are the research firms that do these things. So when you quote those people, it gives you more credibility, more or less. So your question is right, right? Then another thing is tax rate. Tax rate is a general thing. If you run a business in Nigeria today, you have to pay taxes, corporate taxes. Am I right? If you run a business in Nigeria, if it's a business, so it's not a non-for-profit, it's a business, you know, limited by liability. You have to pay taxes. In Nigeria today, it's 10%. 30. Yeah. So, you have to pay that. Does that make sense? So, another thing is, how many months do you have in a year? 12. However, this could be business months. So, this month in a year is actually a business month for business. Some business run 12-month cycle. Some business run six months. You guys don't know that some business just run for 6 months. And they don't sack their employees. I'm serious. So they just run for 6 months, they shut down. Then they will pay you salary for the remaining 6 months, but it's not going to be as much as the salary. Then when they resume next year. No. Example, schools, for example, don't run a 12-month, schools don't run 12-month calendar. Schools, for example, as in, they're in Nigeria. Yes, now. Teachers don't teach all year round now, do they? When you go on break, they go on break too now. So, why are they going on break? What's your school? Relax, okay. But they pay them incentive. They pay them extra for this time learning. So it's not by force now. It's because you want to earn extra cash. But if there's no distance learning, whatever, or if your school decides to employ lecturers suited to that, and as well, why distance? Really? Oh, you are taking the step in the right direction. They now have online programs. Right. Look at when the school is in the bush. It's far. Oh, it's far. Well, it's better than your school. Because you are in the street and nothing is happening. Look at your alumnus, it's Bobisky. What? He has a certificate, so you need last certificate, valid uni certificate. In fact, I know, I have a friend that was in his class when he was in uni life. What kind of advice? Please. Don't go and say that. All right, so as I was saying, what was I saying? No, you can't be risky. You can't be risky. Yeah, so months, right? So these are business months. Schools don't run 12-month cycles. So if, for example, this business was a school, I mean, the months would not be 12. Does that make sense? The months will not be 12. For example, universities run 8-month cycles. They do 4 months of every semester. A semester is 4 months now. And it's 2 semesters in a year. So there are 2 semesters in a year. So they run 8 months business year in schools. Does that make sense? Primary schools. I mean, what's their cycle? Or secondary schools? Yeah, 3 months. They 3 months per term. So they run a 9-month business year. Okay. So if it was a primary school, for example, it would have been 9. All right. But this business runs every day of the year for 12 months. And that's why that is 12 months. All right. So now, if you distill it back to days in month, this business runs 30 days every month. Minimum. They are open every day. 30 days every month they are open. But there are some businesses that, even though it is, so can you see the level of details? So you start big, then you begin to dig deep. Can you see the deductive reasoning? You know. So we start days in here, but even though you work 12 months, does that mean that you work every day? For example, my firm, the firm I work for, they will tell you that you are going to be working 5 days a week, which is a lie, right? But that's what's going to be on their papers. Like they work 5 days a week. Do you get? So in a month, they have how many days? 20. So they tell you that they are optional 20 days on the average every month, but it's a lie. If you go to my office now, they're good there. All right. So days in year. Of course, when you do that, when you multiply 12 by whatever you have, you have the number of days you work in a year, and that's why it is 360. Then if you notice that cells are formatted differently, the cells that are hard coded, when you hard code something, that is typing directly into the cell. They are in blue and all that. The cells that contain formula, they are in the brown, whatever. Do you get? So those are the kind of, you know, simple things you put in your model to make sure that, okay, people don't confuse your formulas for normal text. So when I see a model like this, you know, there's something they call glossary. You have to add a glossary or model, which tells you, you know, how the model is formatted. So when you do that, it means that I can come and play with your model. If you send your model to me, I can come and play with your model and you know, be tweaking these numbers. I can change it as I will. It's not a big deal, right? As long as the formulas don't change, because the formulas are very important. It must be correct. Does that make sense? So now, conversion. This conversion factor is necessary because think about the fact that, I mean, most of the revenue of this business is in millions. So they want to grow maybe by 4x. Then they are not talking about hundreds of millions. I imagine you have to now write 336 million, 357 million thousand. You have to write all of that. You know, it's a lot of numbers, right? So you just format them in millions. And that's why you can see that, you know, there's million naira written as a unit. So you just apply a conversion factor. So the numbers themselves don't change, but they appear as if it's just 3.60. It's actually 3,622,000, something like that. Do you get? Are you guys, I mean, naira, dollar, and you can see the quotation for the, you know, CBN, what is this? Carter Craft. Yeah, that was it. That's the name of the firm I used to work for. I was in that firm when they did this model, CC. So the firm had a small research team. So they also predicted that naira would be 197 naira per dollar in 2020. I wish they knew. Yeah. So now we'll now move to the expansion cost. All right, because these are, I mean, they're trying to raise money, right? So they have to, like, talk about what they're going to use the money for. So this is the part that itemized all the things they want to use the money for. They want to buy computer systems, and that's how much they're going to pay for that, for those computer systems, you know, and base case, worst case, and all of that. Building, rent, furniture and fittings, plants and equipment, motor vehicles, contingency. So for guys that are in accounting, you know that you have to plan for contingencies, right? You guys call it miscellaneous or something like that, right? So it means that after you've done all your numbers, you're still going to put a buffer. So for it's different from industry. I think the standard in accounting is 10%. Is it? What is it? There's no limit. You can just pick your number directly. Okay. So basically, that's what it is. Then total cost per shop. I mean, average total cost per shop was also part of the whatever. But you can see that those costs were not, who knows why they were not projected in the future? Why the cost elements were not projected in the future? Sorry. Exactly. They are one-off investments, one-off expenses. So it happened once and that's it. So you can't project that cost into the future. Does that make sense? All right. So now we've gotten to the revenue assumptions. So offline activities, want to know the number of stores. You know, they want to be increasing their stores. You know. So they have one store, then by 2015 they want to have two, 2016 they want to have three, and they want to have 10 by 2020. Can you see that? So that is their projection of number of stores. Because they are going to be running number of stores, the number of stores is going to be directly proportional to income. Does that make sense? Like if I have one store and I'm making 10 naira, if I have two stores, at least you come 12 naira. Abby? So, growth in sales per comparable store. So they are going to have different sizes of stores, right? Am I that boring? So they're going to be having different, you know, different stores will not, you know, bring sales at the same level. Do you guys understand that? Like an ASOS store in Oxford Street in London does not record the same sales as an ASOS store at Wood Green in that same London. You guys know where Wood Green is, right? Yeah, I like that. So do you guys know Eco-Market in Lagos? Eco-Market? Eco in Lagos Island? Oxford Street is the Eco-Market of London. Yeah, Balogun. Oxford Street is the Balogun of London. And I'm not joking. Is that, well, of course, it's like it's not mushy and shit, it's like really clean, but that's how, like, that's the kind of traffic that Oxford Street is, like, where you want to get anything cheaply. Just go to Oxford Street, you will find it.
Thank you for that.
So when you go, just Oxford Street, it's very popular actually. Things like a train, but depending on where you're staying, right? So, yeah, what'd you say? Oh, Bank of America is not. Bank of America's office is where again? It's not around Fleetwood. Not so far from Fleetwood. Yeah, not so far from Fleetwood. Eh? Eh? You said? Uber, okay. Yeah, there's Uber in London. It's not only in Nigeria that you have Uber. You can buy your way there, but it's going to be expensive, man. Just do train underground, man. As in, by the time you think about it, I mean, I had an air course first time. The guy said $10. I said, I'm not cut it again. $10. That was when it was $2.50 per pound. $2.50, $2,500. I just kept, look, my hair was like this. Yeah, Afro man. I'm the African intern. Alright. So yeah, but so you have to compare stores, right? So like I said, a store in, let me say, if you open a closed store in Lagos, in Balogun, you can compare that store in sales. You can compare the sales volume or value with a store you open in Surulere. Am I right? Because the sales in Balogun will be more, because more people go there, more people frequent that place. Does that make sense? So you have to compare store to store. You know how they say comparing like terms in mathematics, like compare likes with likes, all right? So it's a matter of say, okay, a store in Balogun will do almost the same way like a store in Oshodi Market, right? Sorry, Yaba Market, rather. A store in Balogun will do almost the same thing like Yaba Market. No. Who says no? Why? When it comes to clothes, actually, the clothes are cheaper in Yaba than in Balogun. Yeah, materials, yes. Materials, they are actually cheaper in Yaba than in Balogun. I do a lot of suits, so I know. Then, you want to say something?
Does that mean I found the model of the company that have a lot of products? I'm going to do 3 things for
each of
that product.
You're going to do what?
I'm not going to like 3 things for each of that product.
Yeah, you have to. Why do you think they're paying you? I mean, what do you mean by... Why are they paying you? I mean, if it's not going to be that detailed, then what's the point? Because your firm must have charged Nigerian breweries millions for doing this financial model. Do you know that to take a proper financial modeling class in Lagos, the cheapest financial modeling class you can find in Lagos is around 360,000 naira. Per person. Only by how many people? How many days? 2 days. 2 days, yeah. I did want to. I mean, when I joined Capital Craft, they sent me on the financial modeling class. It was 2 days. In Nikoi. Somewhere in Nikoi. Wiser Consulting. You've done a class before. Which of them?
Financial modeling class.
You did financial modeling class? So why am I going to teach this? Who paid for it? You paid for it? Oh, you said, oh, fantastic. Your work loves you. Where do you work? Huh? You don't take cut out? Oh, you've worked more job. That's a job. So, yeah, come on, please. Yeah, come and finish the class. Let me go and sit. Come and finish the class for me. As in, it's that simple. So, Wiser is one of the cheapest guys, actually. They're actually very affordable. And they charge like 360 per person. It was 2 days now. How many did you guys use it for? No, you did advanced and financial modeling class. Uh-huh. So the advanced part is 3 days, and financial modeling is the last 2 days. Uh-huh. It's 2 days. So, and of which they have to pay for the advanced class separately. You know that, right? So the advanced Excel class costs about 180k. Then financial modeling class costs about 320. So your company has paid how much on you? Exactly. So when you tell your company you want to resign tomorrow, that's why they don't like you when you want to join, because they invested in you. Okay, so yeah, that's the real deal. So advanced Excel class is first 3 days, then they will now do financial modeling class 2 days. Now, Wiser doesn't allow you to just, if you want to take their modeling class for the first time, you have to take the advanced class first. So you have to pay for everything. But they are coming back for a refresher course. They will allow you to take just the advanced financial modeling class, which is 360k. So yeah, just 2 days. Yeah, they are one of the cheapest too. Ah, there is these people, I can't remember their name. They will carry insurance and you'll be doing modeling class insurance. It's about 480 or something like that. 480. Then there are these people too. This one, they will fly you. They'll fly you to Ghana. Huh? Yeah. Yeah, no, no. They'll fly you out. They'll fly you out to Ghana. Some of them, and it's also around 420, 440 or something like that. As in, money is expensive. So now your company that you're working for, they will go and charge Guinness. What they spend 360k on, they will go and charge Guinness maybe like 10 million naira for it. You get? Then Guinness will be like, yeah, we're waiting for United Capital analysis for our business and all that. Then it's just you that dream it. You. So you get? Then you now do it. Then when you don't worry, once you start going to meetings with your boss, you see. Your boss will talk as if they're the ones that did it. And you'll be there, you'll be sitting at the background. You'll be sitting behind us. Listen. So your director's like, yes. So after careful analysis with our experts, you know, team of analysts, we found out that we believe that, you know, your credit load should be this. We expect that you cut down your whatever here, optimize operations here, blah, blah, blah. But it's you that said everything. That what your boss is saying is you that wrote it. So what do you think about our operational factor with respect to the market trend? They are performing below market, but we believe that. So yes, from what I can hear, and based on careful analysis, we believe that, I'm not joking, that's it. Am I lying? I've been following your boss's meetings. Oh, okay. Wait until you go to meeting them. They'll take your glory. Don't worry. You do it to the analyst under you when you become boss. Don't worry, it's normal. You do it to the analyst under you. Alright? So keep calm. Be doing faithfully. Because your time is coming. Your time is coming. You talk about this glory. You've paid your price. Okay? So that's how it works out, right? And your company has charged 10 million naira. Do you get? Then you are now doing it, and it's just you that's doing it. But when you now see in the news that Guinness is about to raise, you know, second public offering. They want to raise 140 million. You know, you can tell that your model that they are using. Do you get? You can tell because you can see the analysis, the underwriters, everything. You are part of the conversation. And that's the joy that comes with the job that you do. Because you can tell that your work is what contributed to this. Does that make sense, guys? So like I said at that time, that's the upside of what you do. You feel fulfillment. You're so fulfilled in what you do because you are part of it. You're making history more. Yeah? Yes. 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 They in fact they want to know. So we tell them, so what have you been doing? Yeah, I worked on this, I worked on that, I worked on this project that led to the eventual second public offering of Guinness, blah 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 blah. What did you do on the project? And you now tell them that okay, I was on to create this model, blah 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 blah. Yeah? Confidentiality. You didn't come and expose their numbers now, and you're talking after the fact. Confidentiality on that is before the fact, right? Because you're a market maker as an investment banker. So that's why there's a Chinese wall. For example, the people you spend that are traders are not supposed to know what you work on. Because they could use that to affect the market in price and all of that. But the IPO has happened. The IPO has gone. It's like if you had one that did Twitter IPO model, they're not talking about it now. What good is your information to me? Do you understand? Of what important information to me now? The IPO happened about 2 or 3 years ago that I did not benefit from. Now you're not saying, but what good it does to me that I can see competence? Okay? That if you can deliver that, you can also deliver something else. Or do I want to jab you that? Okay, how did you guys price that? Because the price was just funny afterwards. What did you do? You get, but that's how it works, right? So you're supposed to compare stock store, yeah?
So since you cannot be a student, you cannot really afford this type of complicated investment. So do you think then you can actually afford?
Yeah, now. Yeah. That's the idea of that's why I was jabbing the guy that said online in the school, right from what school? Relax. He's not with you. That's why I was driving in school because they are doing this learning program and their lecturers are going to teach there. What are they teaching? Yes, because education is cheaper with technology. And that's the idea of what called MOOCs, which Udemy is a part of. Yeah. So the idea is that, I mean, imagine a teacher. If, for example, I'm a teacher right now. How many of us are in this class? Maybe say 20, right? I'm just guessing. And I have to deliver this course to 20 people. But if, because I have to get this place, we have to rent this place, you know, pay for lights, pay for chalkboard, pay for laptop, pay for writing materials, pay for, I'm not saying that we did that now. I'm just saying, you know, hypothetical class. So to do all that, I have to make all those payments. By making all of those payments, I have to pass the cost to you. It's business. Huh? I have to pass the cost to you. So if it costs me 10 naira to get you into this class, I'm not going to charge you 10 naira. I'm going to charge you like 15 naira. Okay? But imagine if you're not online, you don't have to come to class. You don't have to do anything. I just have to sit somewhere and record a video just once. And I put it online and I'm not doing it again. Then instead of having 20 people in this class, I can have 20,000 people. Do I have to still charge you 15 naira? I will charge you about 2 naira. Do you understand? That's the beauty of technology in education. That's why Unilag is not getting it right. Do you get? So, it's as simple as that. Yeah, you guys can tell your professors that we think that this model is not working. We can advise you, and this I mean, you guys are now functional. We can advise you on a much more efficient model. Get after graduation, very key. Because even in OAU, they will victimize you. You know, there are a number of closed stores. Because the truth is that not all stores will perform. They will close some stores. You guys heard about Burberry. They burnt about 31 million. Is that what Bobby? People started bringing that up because people felt it was insensitive to burn $37 million worth of inventory when there are people that don't have clothes. But they had to burn it because imagine if you have to now see Burberry on Saeed. Sorry. The guy is wearing Burberry. I mean, then you're going to go and buy it at end cash. You get now be like, no, I'm not wearing that brand again. So they have to burn it. All right. Usually they confiscate it, actually. Most of the time, they usually confiscate it. But I think they made public this time around and the world did not like it. All right. Everybody just like it's insensible. A whole country will solve their problem. $37 million will solve the problem of the whole country. All right. So that was why they decided, you know, probing them to see if it was even eco-friendly. Because they wanted them to pay for. Why would you do that? I mean, if you even burn it, go and burn it in the backyard. Don't let everyone hear about it. You burn it and you now came out probably say, yeah, we burnt $37 million worth of inventory. I mean, it is what it is. We have to maintain, you know, the best value in the market. Just like Obasanjo, went to Qatar one time, and then he was president of Nigeria. And you know, Qatar is oil and gas. They don't really have oil. They have natural gas, and that's what. And Qatar is one of the richest, Arab Emirates and stuff. And they were talking about this, and I was like, yeah, the oil that you guys produce on a monthly basis, what I flare in my country on a daily basis. You know? So I don't really care about your oil, you know. And you batch your gas. And and it's the truth. You know, Nigeria doesn't explore, and we have gas, but we don't even explore it. We flare it every day. Like, we just burn it. For no reason. And you know that Nigeria is actually has more gas based on geophysics analysis. We have more natural gas than crude oil. But even our crude oil itself, we never even finish them. So that gas, we just waste our say. I mean, we are big boys. You can't import gas and come and sell, you know, cylinder of gas to us at 60,000 naira when we should naturally be having gas for free. Because we are citizens of this country, are we not? And yes, now, if my country is producing gas, please, why am I supposed to be paying for gas? But as basic as that is, I mean, it might look like out of the blues for us because we've not experienced things like that. BlackBerry, for example, is a private business. In the height of in the days when BlackBerry was standing on the pinnacle of smartphones in the world, Canadians don't pay for BlackBerry services. As a private firm, Canadians, you know, BlackBerry is a Canadian firm, right? You guys know that. The old world pays bills of Canadians. All of us that were using BlackBerry Bold 2. Imagine you guys are using the thing that you know. Nowadays, it was Bold 2. Then we used to jab girls on Curve 2. They think girls on Curve 2 are on edge. And you guys don't get a joke. Oh shit, you didn't get a joke. Because there was no 3G at the time. So, Curve 2 was the end of edge technology. They now released Bold 1 and Bold 2 that had 3G. But most of the boys around then could only afford Curve. So anytime you see a girl using Curve 2 and she's trying to shaka, you're just like, Curve 2 girls are always on edge, Shari. So it's a pun on words to say that they're always on edge. And they're also I was getting the joke. So is it pun on words, right? Yeah. By pun, I mean P-U-N.
I know.
Yeah.
You know now.
Yeah. Oh, so that you also need porn stars in P-U-N. But I heard that somebody, I thought you were aiming yourself as porn. Oh, right. Oh. Alright. So, yeah. Now, this business has offline and online activities. So this is the kind of business they want to do on online. So you have to analyze that separately. So speaking to what you said, if they have 20, in fact, they have 1,000 products, we analyze each product separately. You know, part of it. Am I like models now? So somebody would work on something, another person work on another thing, and all that. So that's how. So this, you can tell that this is Wiser Consulting template. That's what I knew it was Wiser all along. Yeah, I did Wiser too. Back in the day. Yeah. Yes, so, where did you think I get it from? You read up, what's your job? Who is this guy? What are you asking? Come on, you're funny. You read it, though. What do you mean by you? Did you read up? Hey, this guy. You will read it. And because you are their consultant, they will be open to you. They may not be explicit because they want to publish those statements to the world, right? They will not be explicit, but you are their consultant, you are their financial advisor. The company I just work with is a financial advisory firm. So part of financial, you know that when it comes to corporate finance has different arms. There is financial advisory, there is private equity, there is underwriting, there is refinancing, there is fixed income. What else? There are a lot of them. Asset management. Research is the back office role. And what else? Security, sales and trading. Yeah. So there are different parts, different angles. So sometimes you find companies that niche, you get. Like the company I used to work for, financial Capital Craft, it was a strictly financial advisory and strategy firm. They don't do M&A, they don't do all of that. It's a matter of, okay, we think that our finance is not going well, help us look at it. So it's like you're going to the doctor, share your get, and your ear is paining you, and I told your doctor that it's my leg. Why you can't tell the doctor it's your leg? You tell the doctor it's your ear now. Because just you and him. Like, he just drove you in the room. It's like your parents are there. You get what I'm saying? So they will disclose that to you, don't worry about that. They will disclose that to you. Maybe not to you directly, but to your boss. Because you definitely have questions. Like, Oga, didn't disclose how they want to go the firm, and I'm seeing this trend. These are questions and all that. Then your boss will talk to their boss. He'll probably take you to the meeting itself. Then they'll now introduce you to their own analyst on the other side, hopefully the female analyst. Then you guys start to collaborate and stuff. Then be like, oh, let's take this conversation outside work, you know. Do you know Casa Lydia? You can just meet up after work and just, you know, do one or two. You know, that's how you do it. Just be learning now. It's not all work. Because not all work, I don't play. Yes, sir. Shoot your shot.
But I didn't play
more. Didn't work? She will tell you more. Wow. Some say, as in, her confidence is boring something. As in, what do you think, Chef? No, okay. Because, man, this, and so that level of her confidence is just high. Like, she will tell me more. Right. Okay, so now we are now, so now we've gotten to the point of expense. So the money they want to raise, how are they going to spend it? And that's what the expense part is. So cost of goods sold, we have to analyze cost of goods sold. All right. And that's also based on, you know, industry average versus what happens in their what they currently do. Okay. Because sometimes some companies are, you know, not very disciplined, but some are more disciplined. It doesn't mean that, you know, so for example, if you are in the telecommunication business and the average across all the telecommunication companies is to maintain a COGS of about 45% of revenue. So their COGS is 45% of revenue. But you now have this company that is called YJ Telecoms. But because YJ is not very disciplined or something like that, YJ is maybe around 48-49% or 50%. It's possible, right? It just means I'm performing poorly against industry average. Does that make sense? So yeah. So you have to do a careful analysis of what they've been doing in the past versus what they hope to do in the future. And if you think that they have actually put the parameters in place to ensure, you know, maintaining that average, then you can project, you know, not partly project, but you can analyze what. How to project that? Does that make sense? If your revenue is increasing, you mean that your operation size is increasing. If your operation size is increasing, what does that mean? The cost of operations will increase. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I have a question. Yeah. So if you actually want to provide a financial advisory service for the company, and then the company follows it to the letter, and then the company goes down the company, you can't really have part of the investment.
No. So the finance is not the only reason why companies go bankrupt or they die. Finance is not. I'm reading a book right now. It's called The Strategist. Because I'm also growing in my career. Authors. Yeah. So I'm beginning to read books on strategy now. And the reason is because I'm also growing my career, I'm becoming more managerial. So part of what I do right now is strategy, actually. So I really don't do my job is not only to maintain the day-to-day activities of the company anymore, it's also to expand it. And expanding the portfolio is strategy, more or less. You have to think into the future, you have to think of how to, you know, you need to have a goal, then you have to start thinking about how to position yourself now to achieve that goal. That's what strategy is, basically, all right? So, and in that book, I read about a company called Masco. It's a furniture company as well. And that's why I came, you know, I told you about IKEA. IKEA is a furniture company. So there was a comparison between IKEA and Masco. Masco was already in household, not furniture, not utensils, for all these things that have to do with taps, bathroom, yeah, some like plumbing, pipes, bathroom, furniture, and all of that. That's what Masco used to be in. And they were great. They were doing fantastically well. They dominated the market. They IPO'd. At some point, they became the king of Wall Street. He wants to expand into the furniture business. So they bought about three or four, you know, companies. They acquired about three or four furniture companies and consolidated those four companies. So they became a big player. Eventually, the company went bust. All right? But the reason why it went bust was because of lack of funds. They had funds. All right? A lot of other things play out in, you know, the execution of operations every day. A lot of many things. You know, the market environment, policies of government, a lot of things. All right. So you can't particularly say that people went bankrupt because they didn't follow financial advisory plans. Let me give you a very valid example. One of my projects is VAT automation in aviation and power sector. Now, thank God that we were fortunate to get two sectors. So, but think about if I just had one sector, and I'll tell you the end of the story. Last month, Bababugu, you guys know Bababugu? I got it off. Bababugu decided to issue an executive order that exempted aviation businesses from paying VAT. What do you think that does to my business if that was the only business I have? I have to go and sack everybody that are working with me and all that. You know, that's how it works. That's how it works. So I could have the best financial plan, financial advisory consultation from maybe say Goldman or anything. But how does that affect Bababugu? Bababugu can just wake up tomorrow and be like, we need to appease that constituency, you know, and they exempt tax for everybody. And that's it. That business went down. So right now, my aviation business is out. Like, out. I'm out of that business. The only good thing was that we saw the trend coming. It didn't happen overnight. All right? We saw the trend coming about a year ago. And we already started positioning ourselves for other sectors. So that was a good thing for me. Because eventually, when it happened, my management even had to, like, you know, like, oh, yeah, that was a nice institutional strategy that I played off there. Okay? Because I saw it coming. Okay? So you have to be abreast of things like that. But honestly, that's not the only reason. I mean, financial advisory is not the only reason why companies fail. That's my question. So, yeah. So, analysis of cost of goods sold, which is COGS. Then I went to SG&A, staff salary. Can you see how detailed this is? Staff cost. Head office. Accountant. CEO. Marketing and sales lead. Sales outlets. How many sales will be in each outlet? How many store attendants will be in each outlet? Everything was like that detailed. So I went to head copper, head annually. Salary of the CEO was 3 million naira per year. Are you following? Salary of the CEO was 3 million naira per year. Storekeeper was 0.6 million, that's 600,000 naira per year, and so on and so forth. Then when I got to the point of admin expense, you guys know what admin expenses are. Yeah, office utilities. I mean, maybe you have a bathroom in the office, for example. You want to put tissue paper there now, and hand sanitizer, and air freshener. So when people go there to fart, you know, the people that use it will not feel the wrath of the last person that used it, right? It's not wrath. I mean, somebody polluted the air. I mean, some people, don't let us get to that. Maybe like tear gas. Do you know what tear gas? Like you can suffocate. Sorry. So yeah, and there's we have to take care of VAT as well. We have to take care of VAT, marketing expenses, telephone bills, their accounting subscription, because they have this accounting application that helps Vend. Accounting, as you know, Vend. Zero. Okay, yeah, then diesel, you know, because they're going to be incurring some diesel costs from, you know, generator and stuff. Then depreciation. And can you see how detailed depreciation is? So, furnitures and fittings, plants and equipment, motorcycle, then also amortization as well. But we couldn't put a value, you know, for amortization because we couldn't value their brand at the time or their intangible assets. You guys know what amortization is, right? Yeah. Okay. No, it's the average. You can't do it over a period of time. Your figure is your figure. The reason why these ones are a percentage of revenue is because for a clothing line, all right, when your marketing increases, revenue is supposed to increase. Does that make sense? So that's why marketing is a percentage of revenue. You can see that some of them were just flat rates. VAT is 5%. You can't do anything about that. You have to charge it. Marketing expense, marketing grows. If marketing grows, your revenue should grow too. Of course, at some point, it should taper, right? Your marketing should taper at some point. But based on the fact that it was a company that was starting, okay, it was clear that they'll still be doing aggressive marketing even into 2020. Do you guys get it? So that's why it was like that. Telephone bills. So the reason why telephone bills was a percentage of revenue was because they have a very strong online business. Now, like I said, when you make order on Jumia, Jumia will still call you, right? That bill, somebody's paying for it, and not you. It's Jumia that's paying for it. You know that, right? So if they have more orders, right, it means that they're going to incur more telephone bills. So it's actually trailing revenue as well. Do you get? So those are the things that you have, and that's the art of it. These are the kind of things that you have to like figure out as an analyst. Because nobody will go and tell you, oh, make telephone bills. But you have to sit down with them, understand the operations, then you can tell that, okay, this will trail revenue, this will not trail revenue. Does that make sense? So see that for Vend was flat rate. It won't change. Do you get? Worst scenario is going to come down. See Dizu. It won't change. Dizu cost per whatever, per shop or per store will be the same. Because they know the number of hours that they want to run Dizu for. They have a specification of the kind of generator they want to buy. And that's the kind of detailed plan that goes into business. That's the difference between a great businessman. When you see this $10 and cool, they think that those boys are just, they're just giving that look. Is it like, if you see the kind of plan that they can tell you exactly what they are putting into their business. You have to be that detailed. Like, okay, I want to be using a 4.5 kVA generator that consumes fuel at 2 liters per hour. That, I'm serious, that's how detailed, because you have to, when it comes to business environment is about what you can control. You can't do business if you can't control the dynamics. It's that simple. If you can't control the dynamics of the business environment you are operating in, you can't make money. If you make money, you are in luck. That is luck, that's not business. That's like lottery. I'm telling you. You have to actively control the environment. Why do you think Dangote, remember when Dangote paid for the salary of Kogi State School? You guys don't remember. Yes, you don't listen to this. Yeah. You know that guy at Dangote Cement? You didn't link that page at the time. Okay, you now know now. You knew of it?
No, I don't know.
Okay. So, you know that there's Dangote Cement, right? You guys know Dangote Cement?
Yeah.
You know that the biggest cement repository in Nigeria is where? Kogi State now. Who is from Kogi State here? Nobody's from Kogi State. Nobody. Ah, interesting. I thought the old 36 states were represented, like federal character. They're from Kogi? Oh. So you know that the biggest cement repository is in your state? You don't know. When last were you in your state?
He's on the salary.
Which journal is this one? This very one that we are just finishing last night. I don't know that your state has a very large repository of cement.
Hey.
Nigerian. You people are just on Twitter. You don't even know what is in your state. How can I do business? You're not like Nigerian youth are lazy. You're not going to be angry. You don't know what's in your state. Natural resource. You guys have. Do you know the biggest uranium depository in Nigeria? Who knows where it is? Uranium, yeah. You don't know there's uranium in Nigeria? But you know where vibranium is? Shame on all of you. All of you, shame. As in, are you kidding? And you're Nigerians. You're not, we are leaders of tomorrow. You are leaders if you don't know the basic things. I'm serious. You should know these things, so. Because how do you know if you can leverage some? Because there are some resources in the backyard. Of course, it's not our fault anyways. I mean, it's not totally our fault because our school did not prepare us for things like this. You know, lack of information is power, right? And there are lots of things that you can literally take advantage of that you don't know. They're probably in your backyard. That maybe your king, the king of your village, is one that just said that, oh. And before you know what's happening, you've created jobs, you've created them, you've become a cut of industry. So basically, Baba has cement interest. One of the biggest cement repositories in Nigeria is in Kogi State. Kogi is owing workers about 6 or 7 months salary. Baba decided to pay the salary of Kogi State workers. Why? Kogi State government, at the expense of Kogi State government giving the license to unilaterally explore cement in Kogi State for the next 13 or 15 years. That's business. There's no game. It's business. He controlled peace. You have to control all your drivers. You need to understand them, and you have to be able to control them. If you don't have control on any particular part of your business, you are just messing up. You are not doing anything. That's an issue. You are not doing anything. And it's possible now that the king of your village is the one like sitting on that cement like this. Like all you need to do is go and say, hello, sir. I'm a student of Unilag. What's up? Oh, wait. That's a lie, right? It's a lie. It's lying. It's not one of us. Is it one of us? It's not. Is it one of us? Taiwo, is it one of us? I now trust you now. I trust you now, Taiwo. I trust you. Is it one of us? You're not sure. I'm not sure too. I'm not sure. Because now I trust Taiwo. We didn't trust him before, but now he's very trustworthy. Very, very trustworthy. Oh my God. So, really, it would just be one king village that would just be like, okay, my son, let's just give you, Dagote, we've already given Dagote a lot. So you just take one small 10 acres, just be playing with it. And before you know what I mean, you also have a cement factory. That's simple. One of the things that, there's hardly any state in Nigeria that doesn't have a natural resource. That's how great this state is. You don't want to know. Ekiti, they have one of the biggest deposits of solid minerals. And by being the new governor, was Minister of Solid Minerals. They didn't do one exploration like this. One. Now he's not governor. Now I'm wondering what he's going to do. But well, there was. Yeah, it's Taraba or something like that. About you, which one of them? One of the big. Is that Bono? About you, one of them. Is it not? Sure. That's very like a good repository of uranium. Huh? Yeah, well, Iran will not do business in Nigeria now. Because you guys don't even have the, those places are safe in a way, they are smarter than Nigeria. How many people have died in Iran this year? Do you know how many people have died in Nigeria this year? As in, the deaths in Nigeria this year have been the highest in the history of this country since after the Civil War. The highest in the history. Throughout last year, I think the number of people that died throughout last year was about 700 and something. This year, we are not even up to half of the month yet, half of the year yet. They already recorded 800 deaths. Do you know what that means? No. Iranians now come here and come on. Huh? Exactly. You now expect Iranians to come and their country. They just kill them away. Okay. OPEC scenarios. So this OPEC scenario is a risk factor actually. It's not a must you put it. Wiser, they taught us to put it, right? OPEC scenario. We're the wiser alumni. Alumnus. Yeah. So it's just a risk. It's a risk factor that you add to your operational analysis. So it doesn't affect the whole model, it just affects the operational piece of your model, right? So just we're saying that, okay, I've created my worst case, second, my base case, my best case, and my worst case, but I'm also applying another risk factor to further discount my activities. Does that make sense? Then we now have operating working capital. You guys understand what that means now? Inventory days, payable days, receivable days, those are the three factors that actually apply to this business. Then we now have financing assumptions. So on the financing assumption part, you have to first take care of debts. It could take, it's not in any particular order, anyways. So it was debt first. So we need to understand debt ratio. Like I told you, I said Nigerians, we know they collect debt, we know they chop debt. This is zero. They don't use debt in this business. Zero. They are not borrowing money from anybody. In fact, you need to see what we're doing that model. I say, I'm not collecting money from anybody. I'll run my business myself. I'm going to touch it. So they don't have any cost of debt. They are not running, totally on equity. Then tenor, nothing, moratorium, nothing. Then equity. Can you see? Equity is 100%. And cost of equity is 27%. And maintenance in perpetuity is not 27% for 10 years. It's 27% in perpetuity. It means that somebody will be collecting 10% of your profit every year. Until he dies. And even if he dies, he's going to pass it on to his next of kin. They now will start collecting it again. Until your company dies, they're collecting it. That makes sense. But you could just have cost of debt of maybe 30% for 2 years, and that's it. Financial intelligence, right? Yeah?
not say the problem. Is there any way to buy some of these power or buy
it? Yeah, you can do a buyback. Yeah, that's it's an exit option. So, I mean, except for maybe for Alphabet. Do you understand? So this is what it is. The company decided to say, okay, since these are Netcom, we don't want to invest, we don't want to do that thing, we want to just keep operations the same. And they share tenure amongst all their shareholders. Do you get? If they share it, maybe their 10 shareholders go to sleep. Everybody's fine. Next year, they make another 10 naira. They share it 1 naira to all shareholders. It works like that. Now, they can decide to reinvest money. Maybe they say, okay, next year we need investment of another extra, 30 naira. But we have 10 naira from retained earnings, right? So let's put the 10 naira in back into the business. Then we're going to borrow 20 naira. Does that make sense? So you've earned the 10 naira, you're still in the business, but you just need to collect it in cash. Here you go. So because of that, the company's value will increase. So you are waiting. So next year, instead of making 10 naira, they now make 50 naira. Instead of to pay you dividends again, they said, I want to invest back in the company. Ah, come on, invest it. It's good. Then they invest again. So in 5 years' time, they want to now buy PO. That's when you now come with your belly. Who are the underwriters? Then the capital comes up and say that they want to. Okay. So since I own 10% of the company, and over time, my shares have grown by this amount, I will sell half of it to UBA. I look at Chop Bellet's money. You know that kind of thing. And that happened. So that's an exit for you. And you can exit totally. You can sell everything. But most of the time, investors don't exit totally. They exit a large portion and they just maybe retain a little bit just to still benefit from the upside of your business. But you know that in Nigeria, it's only in Nigeria that you find investment as a very long-term oriented stock. Like, does anybody, is there anybody here that their parents have shares somewhere? Where? Ask them outside. Dangote Cement. How long have they had? Imagine. We're talking about 20 years and counting. That's Nigeria for you. We just put investments on. We just say, yeah, I'm collecting stuff. It's a lie. Thank God you are now a financial advisor now. So when you get to that, daddy, go and liquidate that investment. Yes, now, because the truth is, it doesn't make any sense. You keep money perpetually in one investment. Not like, the money that I put there, one that I put there 10 years ago, is now 20 naira. Like, really? So? You could have just removed that money, put it inside Flutterwave. Do you guys know Flutterwave?
Yeah.
Flutterwave did 7x in 1 year. 1 year, they did 7x. Do you know what 7x is? 7 times. It's not, that's 700%. In just 1 year, this 700% growth. So instead of me to go and lock money down inside one Benny Cement, what do you call that? That's what imagine. Daddy, let's move that money. Let's go and put in Flutterwave, because in Flutterwave we can 7x. Then in a year, we are out. From that, we can put that money somewhere else again. Before you know what's happening, that's what this guy does now. The wizard of, what's his name?
Omaha.
That's what he does now. Simple stuff. It's called arbitration. That's the standard term for it in investment banking. Arbitration. You benefit from the upside of the market. You buy here, you sell low. You buy low, you sell high, Then you get out. Put your money somewhere else to buy low. But he has gone ahead to start looking for. He will now go and look for businesses that are dying. That's what the guy does now. Do you follow him? Go and follow him on Instagram. If you can't follow him anywhere else, follow him on Instagram. He said very easy. You'll be seeing what he's doing. Look, you go and buy companies that are dying. You buy it. injects Harvard boys into their board, the company rise up again. So he buys them undervalued. You just can bring Harvard boys. And do you know that the salary of the Harvard boys are the money that he has put in, that's what they begin to pay the salary of the Harvard boys. So it's win-win for him. Then the business goes back again and sell it. You know, like, yeah, like you said, that 5x. It wasn't a really fantastic investment, but we did 5x, you know, over the course of 3 years. That's business. That's financial intelligence. Okay? Any question? So, yeah, do you guys know what risk-free rate is? Risk-free rate. What is risk-free rate? On government securities, yeah. And risk-free rate is different from country to country because it applies just to government of that country. Does that make sense? Because it's assumed that the government of a country cannot go bankrupt. Yeah. Even Zimbabwe has not gone bankrupt, right? You guys know now that to buy bread with bamboo, you have to carry wheelbarrow. Like, we are now. So if me and Emeka go and start a business in Zimbabwe now, Emeka and sons, just go and start a bread business. How much money do you think we need? Importer, exporter. And Emeka will be good for this thing because it's an Igbo boy. He's just like, I have 7 containers and ICs. And that's straight up. So, the risk-free rate in Nigeria is about 13% at time. And then you guys know what return on market is. Return on market. You guys have been taught this now. You guys have been taught valuation. So, you have been taught return on market. You want to try? Yeah, because it's too hard. That year was 2014. Yeah. Yeah, it was 2014. So what's the sort of markets, guys?
The return on market is like what the market is for taking the salary for the
investment. Yes, always higher than risk-free, yes. And or it's ideally supposed to be higher than risk-free. In Nigeria, it's not higher than risk-free. Sorry. In fact, that's why we chose that 30%, so that investors would not look funny. Return on market, there's a formula for return on market now. RM equals RF plus RL clinical. Do you guys have that formula now? Valuation, I can't remember that formula again. You got the what? Oh, this capital.
Yeah.
Plus R what? So capital is a model, right?
Yeah.
For getting return on market. Then what's beta? Rate of volatility, of course. Rate of volatility. Market volatility. And so a company that has a volatility of 1, what does that mean? 1. Exactly. So what if it has 0.8? What does that mean? Yes, less volatile than the market. And if it's more, it's more volatile than the market. So say, during Ebola time, for example, who was most hit by Ebola? What industry in Nigeria was most hit? What sector was most hit in Nigeria? Pharmaceuticals? There's no drug for my Ebola, no. Hand sanitizers! As in, that was selling like Omo. As in, there are no two ways about it. Like, one of our neighbors that he started business, hand sanitizer business, let's forget it. As in, next minute, they are importing and exporting hand sanitizers into this country. I didn't even know what hand sanitizer. Okay, I saw hand sanitizer once. And I saw it with a doctor. And he had this very small one. It was OAUTH. So the guy, one of the, he just was doing residency at the time. I know you boys, you know. When they start doing their residency, they now turn to big boys. Because they're earning 120k a month. All of them. CAP is a model for extracting this piece. Yeah, that's what that model.
But the model, you have the current return on market. Then inside the function itself, as the RM, this time, we have RM there.
Do you have RM?
Yeah,
oh, this, so CAPM equals RF, okay. Whack. What's whacking? Sorry, what's whacking, guys? I'm forgetting this thing. Cost of common? Yeah, with weighted average cost of capital. Okay. Let me see, because you're making sense. Yeah? You don't know market RF minus. So I don't have the formula here. Do you guys have it in your textbook? The Midnight Manual. What's that? That's capital asset pricing model, and it is the risk-free rate return on government, which is return on government bills, and blah blah blah. And they just assume this. It's something else. No, it's not too explicit. The Kaplan's pricing model. Yeah, so it's here. This return on market. So that's, this is where the confusion was. So what ER means? Beta market volatility. What do you call it? This is CAP now. CAP. So I have a cost of equity. According to Wikipedia. Wikipedia says here with expected return. R minus RF. Market. Yeah, risk is always given. The problem here is the return on market. On the ocean index. Everything going as an area. This minus this is going to be your premium. That extra premium you get if you for investing in the market. Because you've taken out the risk-free portion of the mix. I'll confirm this because to be honest, I'm already still in this. I wrote the formula for that and it was 27%. RF plus beta blah 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 blah. But you guys can confirm with your valuation midnight manual valuation. What else? Any question? So you guys know what the dividend payout ratio is?
Yes.
What? Any questions? Hi. That's why they call this class, integrated financial modeling. Do you know what integrated science is? Is not what you study? it's not what you study in university, right? So that's exactly what this is. It's integrated financial modeling. You said? Integrated finance in university and education. So it means that the main component is education. Okay now. What else? You come and meet our Rihanna, right? Shakira. If you have 360k, that you have 4. She can connect you. But honestly, I like the model in the day now. Who? I'm the one that will tell you. You have to figure it out, but it's very simple. Point me teaching you. You can just go and Google how to use merge or index function on YouTube. Yes, can. I didn't even use merge. And when I presented my own scenarios, I didn't use merge. So the thing about Excel is that Excel is very robust. You can do many things different ways. There are many ways to skin a cat, right? I didn't use merge and index here, but you can use merge and index. Here, I think I used index. Yeah, so for this, I use index. And for this toggle, it wasn't index. This toggle was, I can't remember. No, it's not the tab edition. If I have this tab, developer, Java developer tab on your Excel. On your Excel, if you have developer tab on Excel, you need to add books, you see tabs, activate the developer tab. Yeah. Any question, anybody? Any question, guys? You said? Thank you.